It is exactly 7:30. Should I start?
Yes.
Do I have your permission? Hello.
Go ahead, Tempted.
Yeah, should I start? Yes. I'm Tempted Dalal speaking, Chairman, Mumbai Committee of WZCC. I welcome each and every viewer from India and abroad for this wonderful webinar on Nanak Palkhivala, the legend of our times, the finest advocate, the finest solicitor of our time. It is indeed, we are lucky that he was a Parsi and has been a great orator of our time, which we have never seen before. The first item on the agenda is to speak about WZCC. Actually, Behrouz was supposed to speak on this subject, but as she has gone to Devlali and is not able to reach us today, I will speak on her behalf. World Zartosti Chamber of Commerce was formed more than 20 years ago, and we had some of the outstanding personalities in the Parsi community, like Mr. Meenu Shroff, Adel Dawar, Percy Master, and several other people. The very existence of WZCC is to promote, advance, and protect trade, commerce, and industry in India, generally and particularly to promote the interest of the Zarthostis, business organization, or individually, and also for the professionals. It is exclusively a group of WZCCs for the Parsis or Zarthostis only. We have three chapters at the moment in Bombay, Bangalore, and Pune. Just last year in the month of January 2020, we had a grand conclave AGM meeting in Lonavala in January 2020. And the next was to be held in London in May 2021, but due to the COVID-19, it has been now postponed to October. One of the most outstanding feature of WZCC is that loans are given to young, budding entrepreneurs and business people without any interest to promote Zarthostri youth to do great business throughout India, and if certain times, if need be, also abroad. For all these things, we have to contact Mr. Aspi Atia at the registered office of Ghamadia Colony of Mumbai chapter. Before I proceed to introduce my very dear friend, Rajan, with his permission, I shall read a very inspiring will of Sri Nani Ardeshir Palkhivala, who was born on the 16th of January, 1920, and passed away from our midst on the 11th of December, 2002. See, the brain of a genius works entirely in this fashion. When I die, give my sight to the man who has never seen a sunrise. Give my heart to the one who has known the agony of the heart. Give my blood to a youth pulled from a wreckage of a car so that he might live to see his grandchildren play. Let my kidneys drain the poison from another person's body. Let my bones be used to make a crippled child walk. burn what is left on of me and scatter the ashes to the wind to let the flowers grow. If you must something, let it be my faults and my prejudice against my fellow men. Give my sins to the devil, give my soul to the God. If you wish to remember me to do it with a kind deed or a word to someone who needs you, and if you do all I have asked, I shall live forever in your mind for ages and ages to come. Signed, Nani Ardashir Palkiwala. I have now a wonderful duty to perform, and that is to introduce my very dear friend, one of the finest solicitors of our time, who is also an advocate, Mr. Rajan Jaikar, practicing in the Bombay High Court in the firm and name of Messrs. Jaikars since 1971. Several prestigious positions are held by him. Convener of the Indian National Trust for Art Cultural Heritage of Mumbai Chapter. Trustee, Bhavdaji Lad Museum. Member, High Powered Committee appointed by the Bombay High Court for the beautification of Birgam Chowpatty. Past Vice President of the Asiatic Society of Mumbai, where it is also there in London today. Trustee, Atmaram Bua's Sri Ram Mandir at Thakur Dwar, Mumbai. Past member of the Mumbai Heritage Conservation Committee appointed by the Maharashtra government. Trustee of the We Citizens Action Network and trustee of the Hans Maharaj Trust at Lavacha, Gujarat. A scholarly pursuit of this great solicitor of ours, Mr. Rajan Jaikar. He has written articles in prestigious magazines, journals, and newspapers, addressed seminars and lectures on the legal topics, history of the Bombay Pathare Prabhu community, hobbies, and collections. Presently writing a coffee table book, Legal Bombay, on the history of judicial institutions on the islands of Bombay between 1296 and 1247. Purpose is to write the coffee table book on the history, arts, heritage, and culture of Pathare Prabhu community to which my dear Rajan belongs. Purpose is to write coffee table for the book Memorabilia, showcasing old Bombay through picture postcards and physical objects. Well, Rajan has addressed several webinars on the diverse subjects, starting firstly from Nani Palkiwala, God's Gift to India, Bombay Memorabilia, Saving Esplanade Mansion, Traditions of the Courts in Bombay, Watson's Esplanade Hotel, History of the Courts in Bombay from 1296 to 1947. The hobbies of our great solicitor is collection of historical material of old Bombay, including maps, photographs, lithographs. Represents India in world map exhibitions and have secured gold medals for the country on the subject of judicial and non-judicial stamps and stamp papers of the British India. He is a holder of the Limca Book of Records holder for the highest collection of matchbox labels in India, totaling to about 2.5 lakhs, including 125 years matchbox labels of Tata and Sons collection. Collection of the old advertisements, kitchenware of the Pathare Prabhu, Victorian furniture, cigarette cards and packets, monogram, coat of arms, textile labels, Bombay mint coins, British Indian currency, and many, many more. I now move on to the exhibitions he has curated as a hobby. It's his left-hand job to curate such exhibitions. Co-curated exhibition of the Bombay High Court to commemorate 125 years in 1987 was inaugurated by the governor of Maharashtra. Co-curated exhibition of Old Bombay at the Town Hall in 1992 showing Pathare Prabhu household, which was also inaugurated by the governor of Maharashtra. Curated exhibition of the personal collection of the judicial archives to celebrate 100 years of Bombay Incorporated Law Society at society's premises in the High Court. Mind you, Incorporated Law Society is exclusively for the Solicitors of India. Curated exhibition of personal collection of picture postcards of old Bombay to commemorate 125 years of Bombay Port Trust at the Darbar Hall of the Asiatic Society of Bombay in 1998, which was inaugurated by the chairman of the Bombay Port Trust. Curated exhibition of personal collection of picture postcards of the old Bombay to commemorate 150 years of David Sassoon Library premises in 1999. Also inaugurated by the governor of Maharashtra. Curated exhibition of personal collection of lithographs, engravings and photographs of the old Bombay at David Sassoon Library in 2000, again inaugurated by the governor of Maharashtra. Curated exhibition to celebrate 50 years of the Supreme Court of India at the National Museum in New Delhi in 2000, inaugurated by the Chief Justice of India. Curated the traveling Supreme Court exhibition at Prince of Wales Museum in 2000, inaugurated by the Governor of Maharashtra. Curated exhibition to commemorate 200 years, the birth of Dr. John Wilson at the Wilson College in 2004, also inaugurated by Governor of Maharashtra. Curated the exhibition to celebrate 175 years of the Bombay University at the Fort Library, below Rajabai Clock Tower in 2005, which was inaugurated by none other than the President, Dr. APJ Kalam, and visited by the Prime Minister of India, Mr. Manmohan Singh, and the closure at the hands of the President of India, Srimati Pratibha Thai Patel. Curated exhibition as a tribute to Shammi Kapoor of personal collection of memorial at the Prince of Wales Museum in October 2011. Curated exhibition to celebrate 150 years of the Bombay High Court in the Central Courtroom on the 15th of August 2012 to 23rd October 2012 was inaugurated by the Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court and was visited by the President of India, Prime Minister of India, Chief Justice of India, Governor of Maharashtra and Goa, and judges of the Supreme Court, councils, and other great dignitaries. And I know it is a little longer, but he has refurbished the museum in the Madras High Court. But the cherry on the cake is the setting up of the museum very recently in Bombay High Court in 2005, which was inaugurated by our own Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, and visited by the judges of the Supreme Court of India and the British judges. All of them have complimented the great Rajan. With these words, I now, ladies and gentlemen, fellow viewers, present to you Rajan Jaikar.
Thank you for the long introduction, which contained a lot of things which were not part really from my profession, but really by hobby. I must thank at the outset the World Zarathustra Chamber of Commerce, Mumbai chapter, for giving me an opportunity to talk on a person on whom I can keep on talking for hours together. Anyway, time being a limitation here, I will deal with only two aspects of Nani. First thing is his life sketch, as well as Nani as a lawyer. A lot of people who are not lawyers, they always wonder what are these cases like Keshavananda Bharati and P.V. Percy's Nash, then bank nationalization, etc. So I'm going to go a little detail, but not very much in detail, as I know that I'm addressing an audience of lay people. Let us start with the birth of Nani Palkhivala, who was born on 16 January 1920, and now we are celebrating the 101 years of his birth anniversary. His parents were Sherbanu and Ardeshir, and his elder sister was Amy, and younger brother was Behra. Ardeshir, his father and his uncle were in the business of building palanquins, as there were no other vehicles, palanquins were the one which were the transport in Bombay in the late part of 19th century. But with the advent of the motor car, the business stopped. Nani, being born in a middle class family, he had to struggle hard to really make his whatever little pocket money that he could assemble. And he studied in proprietary high school, master tutorial high school, and developed a hobby of reading books. To save money for buying books and pay tuition fees, he used to give tuitions to junior students and played violin at Parsi weddings. As Nani grew, so did his appetite for the books on philosophy, art, history, literature, science. And his authors were Macaulay, Emerson, Gardiner, Chesterton, Johnson, Shakespeare, and Dickens. Quite heavy names for a young boy. Nani had to overcome two impediments. This is something which is absolutely fantastic. And through the genius of Nani, he could do it. He had a stutter. One of the world's best speakers started his life with a stutter, and he had a writer's cramp whereby he could not write properly. He overcame the stutter by participating at the age of 11 years in elocution competition, and his subject was try and try until you succeed. I think the most appropriate subject he would have ever chosen. He won a special mention for his effort. He actually had to have a writer for his LLB and original side advocates exam, and the writer was Nargish Malbar. We'll come to her a little later. Nani eventually passed his matriculation exam in 1936, his VA exam in 1940, and his MA exam in English literature in 1942. Next. After doing his LLB examination, he joined the chamber of Sir Jamshedji Kanga, one of the most leading lawyers of that time during the British period. Kanga himself was an advocate general during the British period. And Kanga's chamber was not big enough for Nani to get a big table space. So he was given a small table, as there were other battery of senior advocates in the chamber of Jamshedji Kanga, being Hormaji Sirwai, Marzaban Mistri, Rustam Kola, Karsheji Baba, and others. Whenever, as a junior, Nani had to hold a conference, since there was no space, he had to go to the car park in the High Court compound and hold a conference in the car. But subsequently, with the rise of Nani's intellectual capacity, he was given a little bigger table, and he started his practice in that chamber. Nani eventually married his writer in the examinations, Nargis Malbar, on 9th of April 1945 at Al Bagh in Mumbai. Now, the Jamshedji Kanga was one of the most leading consultant on taxation laws. So obviously the kind of work that came to Jamshedji Kanga was mainly taxation. So in the taxation, there are two things. One thing is you appear in court, tribunals, and at the same time, business people want the opinion as to what would be how to best save the tax, etc. So Jamshedji Kanga, seeing Nani's likeliness for taxation laws, he started sending the opinions which were given to him for drafting to him, so that he could make a first draft, and then Kanga would have a look before the opinion is finally given. With the passage of time, it so happened that all the opinions that Nani used to give and pass it on to Kanga, there was hardly any alteration, and those opinions were given as final opinion in the name of Kanga. Imagine, after joining the chamber in 6 years only, Nani wrote the magnum opus, The Law and Practice of Income Tax. And although the authors of the book were shown as Kanga and Palkiwala, Kanga had publicly mentioned that it was out of respect that his name was added, but the entire work was done by Nani. By 1976, the book ran into 7th edition, and it was considered to be Bhagavad Gita of taxation law. Next. No wonder that since he was good in taxation, that his future course of action in taxation would start. Incidentally, few businessmen and industrialists had set up a forum of free enterprise in 1950 for popularization of the virtues of economic liberation, particularly since Nehru wanted to set up a socialistic pattern of society. The forum organized public meetings to be addressed by stalwarts such as Meenu Masani, Dandekar, the managing director of ACC, M.A. Master, S.N. Subnis, shipping magnate, A. Jasdanwala, industrialist, and even R.V. Murthy, journalist. A.D. Shroff asked M.R. Pai to get some young speakers when the name of Nani came up, who had already made a mark as tax expert. So in July 1957, Nani had spoken to the members of the Institute of Chartered Accountants, and that talk was reported by none other than Jame Jamshed and was widely appreciated. So on 27th of March 1958, Nani was called upon to deliver the annual lecture, first annual lecture on budget at Green's Hotel at Apollo Bandar, where today the Taj Intercontinental stands. A.D. Shroff, the president of the forum, presided over the function, which you can see in the picture, and Mr. Pai is also sitting next to him. Shroff was so impressed by the lecture that he asked Pai to bring him for the next budget speech also. Next. Now, Nani's budget speeches started becoming so popular that it was not possible for the hall in the Green's Hotel to hold the audience, which came in hordes. So Nani's budget, so ultimately, the forum in 1965 decided to shift the lecture to Sir Tawaji Jangir Hall, which is today called the NGMA, which is opposite to the Prince of Wales Museum. Even that particular hall was also not adequate. So next. So in 1966, the first open-air budget lecture was delivered as East Lawns at CCI. Special arrangements had to be made for chairs for the invitees and as well as for the members of public to sit. The Vijay Merchant, who presided over the function as the chairman of CCI in 1982, noted the overflowing crowd and suggested that from 1983, the lecture should be held at the Brabham Stadium itself. One of the lectures, as you see in the picture, in 1974, the chief guest for the budget speech was none other than Mr. Justice M.C. Chagla, one of the most competent judges Bombay High Court has ever produced. In 1971, 1977, and 1980, since the budgets were presented in the monsoon session, the lectures could not be held in open air, with the result that they were held in Shanmukhananda Hall. They were there also, the capacity of the hall being 3,000, the crowd being overwhelmingly more than 3,000, they had to put mics installed outside so that the people who could not get an entry into the auditorium could listen to the lecture. Eventually, from 1983 onwards till 1994, when Nani delivered the last lecture, the lectures were held at the mammoth Brabham Stadium. Now, as a cricket enthusiast, I know that the capacity of the Brabham Stadium for a cricket match is about 35,000. But Nani's lecture had an audience of about 1 lakh, because the balance people who could not sit in the stadium were sitting on the ground. So these lectures became so popular that and were regularly attended by personalities like J.R.D. Tata, Meenu Masani, Sourabh and Barjor Godrej, Aditya Birla, H.T. Parekh, Ramkrishna Bajaj, Dhirubhai Ambani, and several Tata directors, some high court judges, members of the income tax department itself. On one of the occasions, Lord Roll of Ebsden was asked to preside over the function in 1986. And in his presidential address, he mentioned that nowhere in the world would a budget speech would attract such large audience. Now, during emergency, CCI was given a show cause notice by collector for violating the terms of lease by using the ground for non-recreational purposes. Nani dictated the reply and stated that intellectual recreation was also covered by the said clause of the lease. Nothing happened thereafter. Nani was called upon to give budget lecture at various cities in India and abroad. Next. This is the picture which shows that Lord Roll of Ebsden, who was invited to become the president, is just standing with the other dignitaries before the lecture started, which includes Sam Manekshaw, as well as Mr. Vijay Merchant and Madhav Apte, who was by then the president of CCI. Next. Nani wrote a series of books on such as Taxation in India, published by the Harvard University in the World Tax Series. The next was The Highest Tax Nation, which forced the government to reduce ridiculously high taxation rate of 97.75%. The other books being Constitution Defaced and Defied, A Judiciary Made to Measure, We the People, and We the Nation. Apart from this, Nani authored several articles in prestigious publications in India and abroad. Seeing Nani's popularity as well as ingeniousness, Nani was invited by the senior director A.D. Shaw, the one who was there in the Forum of Free Enterprise, to join the Tatas as a legal advisor in 1961. Next. Shortly thereafter, Nani became the legal advisor to the entire Tata group and the right-hand man of Chairman J.R.D. Tata, although in the present picture you see it on the left-hand side. As you are aware probably that Nani served as chairman of TCS, ACC, Voltas and Tata Exports. He was the vice chairman of TISCO and Telco. He was also director of Tata Sons, SK Bearings and Nosil. He was on the board of RBI, ICICI, Press Trust of India and several overseas companies. He was also elected as an honorary member of the Academy of Political Science, New York. Now let us come to Nani as the ambassador. Nani never wanted to enter politics. It was after Morarji Desai, who became Prime Minister of India in 1977, he invited Nani to become ambassador of India to the US. Nani declined. But Desai sent his External Affairs Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee to Mumbai, and he somehow persuaded Nani to accept the quasi-political office. Replying to Nani's, and when Nani went to USA and tendered his credentials, replying to Nani's speech at credential ceremony on 7th of October 1977, President Jimmy Carter welcomed Nani and replied, "My exposure to India has been indirect, but intimate and long-standing. My mother's service," he is referring to Lillian Carter, "near Bombay has left on me an indelible sense of rich fabric of Indian life and of the great efforts that are being made to achieve a better condition of life. I welcome you personally, Mr. Ambassador. Your reputation in India as a champion of human rights and constitutional liberties achieved at some personal risk at times precedes you. I am certain that your mission will be as effective and successful one and will contribute to that enhancement of our relations of which both of our countries are committed. My administration and I will look forward to a pleasant and constructive association with you, Mr. Ambassador, and your government as we work to achieve common goals, which will be the direct benefit not only to our two peoples, but to the cause of world peace, stability, and progress. I cannot imagine any other ambassador getting such accolades from a president of the United States at personal level. In 1977, unfortunately, Nani, of course, resigned as an ambassador in 1979 because he felt that he was more required in India for things which were happening, of which we'll take a note a little later. In 1977, he addressed the United Nations General Assembly against the apartheid policy of South Africa and asserted the principles of human dignity, equality, and freedom. Next. While he was in US, his reputation and his genius was accepted and appreciated by so many universities. In 1978, he was conferred the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws by Princeton University, New Jersey, USA. In 1979, he was conferred the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws by Lawrence University, Wisconsin, USA. Apart from that, he was asked to address in many universities on fundamental rights, democracy, etc. Nani addressed the students of Yale University, law students of Yale University in US in 1978. Nani was such a popular person, as you can see from the image, that even the ambassador of Pakistan, Sahibzada Yaqub Khan, in New York, has embraced Nani with reverence and respect. Next. This picture is very relevant with Nani, with Lillian Carter, mother of the president of the Jimmy Carter, at the University of North Florida, Jacksonville, USA in 1978. I must tell you at this juncture that at this particular meeting, somehow the other, Lillian Carter could not put her foot into her shoe. And Nani, showing the courtesy, bent down and put the shoe in her feet. There was a lot of criticism that an ambassador should not be doing all these things, but Nani was acting in a humanitarian manner. There was nothing like an ambassador. He treated Lillian Carter as a great senior, and therefore what he did. Nani respected all religions. He would visit the head of the religious sect, etc., very often. Nani respected Satya Sai Baba. He attended the convocation of the Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. Nani had a special regard for Jagatguru Sri Chandrasekharananda Saraswati of Kanchi. When Nani was offered the post of ambassador, he came to Kanchipuram and sought his blessings of Jagatguru and also his consent so that he could accept the office. Next, Nani donated without publicity. This is one quality which ultimately the fact of his donation used to come out by some other means, but he never himself publicized it. He donated 10% of his net income every year to Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan because he appreciated the activities done by the institution. He bequeathed his shares worth 51.61 lakhs and fixed deposit worth 2 crores to the Medical Research Foundation of Sanchara Netralay in Chennai. And that was also done in such a manner that he invited the chairman for dinner at his place. And while he was leaving, he just slipped an envelope in his hand and told him to see it after he goes home. He was very curious. He, of course, did not open it in his presence. When he sat in the car, he opened and found a check for rupees 2 crores. Nani, during his lifetime, received a lot of honors, to name a few. In 1990s, he was honored as a Person of the Year Award by Limca Book of Records. Now, this was because continuously he has been holding budget speeches with an audience of more than 1 lakh, which no one in India would have done, and therefore he walks into the Limca Book of Records. 1998, he was conferred degree of Doctor of Laws by the Bombay University. In 1998, again, was conferred Padma Vibhushan by the President of India, which is the image you can see on your screen. In the year 2000, he was conferred the degree of Doctor of Laws by Manipal Academy of Higher Education. Next. Nani always liked to celebrate his birthdays in the presence of his friends, acquaintances, and family. Here is a very beautiful picture of Nani replying to the good wishes given to him by the earlier speakers on his 75th birthday. And the speakers also included Om Hormaji Sivai, another constitutional giant, and his opponent in one of the very leading cases to which we'll come shortly. You can also see Minu Masani and Mrs. Palkiwala in the image. Next. This is, in my opinion, a little sad picture, but well, all good things have to end. Here is Nani in the year 2000. By that time, he was completely immobile. He was non-communicative. And these were the twilight years of Nani, which he spent in the presence of his family members. Next. Finally, the inevitable had to happen. Nani received a paralytic stroke in 1996. And he immediately resigned from Tata Group. And in 1997, even resigned as the chairman of ECC. His life partner, Nargesh, who always remained in the background but supported every activity of his, who are herself also a lawyer, but she remained in the background. She passed away on 4 June 2000, which was another shock, after which Nani did not last long and finally breathed on 11 December 2002. After his demise, next, the postage stamp was issued and the first day cover was also issued in the honor of Nani on 16th of January 2004, which was his second death anniversary, after his death by Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And you can see the ceremony as well as the poster which was issued. Now let us come to Nani as the lawyer. This is something which I have seen myself being a lawyer. Nani appeared in about 1,500 major cases, including cases on taxation law, constitution, company law, etc. Nani was offered the position of Attorney General of India at a very young age of around 40. and also a direct elevation to the Supreme Court of India, but he refused both positions, saying that he would serve the citizen better by remaining as an independent advocate. Imagine if Nani was to accept being a Chief Justice of India, he would have been there as a Chief Justice for more than 20 years, something which has never happened before. Next. Now see Nani's performance abroad. He successfully represented India in the 1966-67 in boundary dispute near the Run of Kutch against Pakistan and before Indian Indo-Pakistan Western Boundary Case Tribunal, and he succeeded in retrieving the territory for India. In 1971, he represented India against Pakistan in the Indian Airlines hijacking case before International Civil Aviation Organization at Montreal. Unfortunately, he lost the case, but an appeal was made in 1972 before the International Court of Justice, that is the World Court, where he succeeded. Now let us see, as I said, people have been talking about Golaknath case and this and the other. Let us see what these cases are about and what is Nani's performance. This is a case, Golaknath versus State of Punjab, 1967, called the Fundamental Rights Case. I will not go too much into the background because how that case arose is something which you can always find out on internet, or there are several books written on Nani. But suffice it to say that I must introduce what the case was. I see Golaknath, the petitioner, inherited certain agricultural lands along with his siblings. However, about 418 acres of land were declared as surplus by the Punjab Finance Commissioner, and only 30 acres was allowed to be distributed among the siblings. Golaknath's family challenged the said ruling in Punjab High Court in 1965, but they lost the case. Golaknath filed a petition in the Supreme Court challenging the Punjab Act 1953 itself on the ground that their right to acquire and hold a property and their profession was infringed. The right of equality before law and equal protection was also infringed, and they sought to have 17th Constitution Amendment set aside, although it was placed in the 9th schedule of the Constitution. Now let me just give you a little background that when the Constitution was framed, there were 8 schedules. By the first Constitution Amendment in 1952, 9th schedule was added, whereby any law which is put in the 9th schedule cannot be challenged in any court of law. This was basically because there were agrarian reforms which Nehru government wanted to put beyond the challenge of any person. But subsequently what happened was that with the 9th schedule available, government started putting all sorts of laws into the 9th schedule and to keep them away from the challenge. A bench of 11 judges of the Supreme Court, presided over by Chief Justice Subba Rao, and other judges like Justice Wanchu, Hidayatullah, J.C. Shah, Sikri, Bachawat, Ramaswamy, Shelat, Bhargava, Mittar and Vaidyalingam was constituted. And senior advocate Nambiar, who is the father of the present Advocate General, Attorney General of India, Mr. Venugopal, was the lead counsel along with A.K. Sen, Pali Nariman, M.C. Settlewad, Mani, Garg and Parasaran, who appeared for various petitioners. The petitioner's advocate started facing rough weather from the bench, and they found that the matter was going out of hand. What happened was that Solicitor Popat, the partner of Mullah Craigie Blunt and Cairo, phoned Nani when Nani was actually at that time representing India in Switzerland in the Run of Kutch case. He said that this is a very important matter. You please come, because otherwise if you lose this matter, then it's going to be a very serious consequence. Nani said, I am on my legs. I can at the most come for a day. So Nani takes a flight from Switzerland on Saturday, lands in India on Sunday. Mr. Popat and Mr. Fali Nariman go to receive him at the airport. On their way back to the hotel, they brief Nani as to what has happened. And Nani said that I must get a chance on Monday to argue, because Monday evening I have to go back to Switzerland. Now, Mr. Nambiar was already on his legs. He cannot just sit down. So when the barrage of questions started coming up from the bench, Mr. Nambiar said that these questions which are put by your lordship, I can only answer after I give it a little thought. And while I'm doing so, I would, if your lordship permits, let Mr. Palkiwala address you. And the Supreme Court very gracefully allowed Palkiwala to argue. And Palkiwala argued for one day, and the performance was such that Nambiar had to do nothing thereafter. And in that one day, he turned the whole tables. The judges were completely silent. But, and with a very paper-thin majority of 6-5, the petitioner, Golaknath, succeeded. And what is the outcome? The court held that if there is any law, whether it be ordinary law or a constitutional amendment passed, which infringes the fundamental rights, that particular law is to be declared invalid. Now, this was a very, this was not only a turning point, but a judgment which would have made all earlier constitutional amendments straight away void if they affected the fundamental right. So, government of the day went in panic. What they did next was that in 1970, the government again, in order to establish the socialistic pattern, they wanted to take over the banks because they thought that by controlling the economic, by controlling the banks, they would be able to achieve their target of greatest good for the greatest number. So Pandit Nehru's secularism was based on economic policies in India, whereby state controlled important industries. In 1955, Imperial Bank of India was taken over under State Bank of India Act. Reserve Bank of India reduced number of commercial banks from 566 in 1951 to 89 in 1969. Indira Gandhi, the then Prime Minister, promulgated Banking Companies Acquisition and Transfer of Bank Undertaking Ordinance in 1969 on 19th of July 1969, whereby she nationalized 14 banks having deposits exceeding 50 crores. Thereby, 75% of the banking sector came directly under the state control and provided for compensation to be paid after the tribunal is appointed by the central government to decide the quantum, and no cash would be paid, but it will be invested in government securities payable after 10 years. In less than 48 hours, Nani Palkiwala drafted and moved a petition in the Supreme Court in the name of R.C. Cooper, the director of Central Bank of India. The petition was filed on 27th of July 1969, and interim order restraining the implementation of the ordinance was granted on 22-7-1969. When the matter finally came up for hearing, the questions that were posed were whether a shareholder could file such a petition, because R.C. Cooper was not a bank, he was a shareholder. And although he was an office bearer of the bank. Secondly, whether the ordinance was valid. Thirdly, whether the act which ultimately replaced that ordinance was validly passed by the parliament. Fourthly, whether the act violated fundamental rights under Article 19(1)(f), that is right to property, and 31(2) regarding right to acquire, hold, dispose of property, and whether the method of calculation of payment of compensation was reasonable, because the compensation was not going to be paid upfront, but it was going to be paid after 10 years. Nani laid the argument on behalf of the petitioner, and ultimately court by a majority held that activities other than banking cannot be acquired under the act. Because see, the banks were not only carrying on banking activities, they are doing other activities also. And the compensation which was to be paid should be equal to the value of the property and not something to be decided unilaterally and paid. Supreme Court therefore struck down the takeover of the non-banking business, and sizable compensation was paid for acquiring banking business. So that was the success in the bank nationalization matter. The next matter which came up was the Privy Purses. Now, this is Madhavrao Scindia versus Union of India, which was in 1971. Now, little history of this Privy Purses. At the time of independence in 1947, princely states covered 48% of the territory of Indian dominion and formed 28% of its population. Under Indian Independence Act, which is the British Act of 1947, by which India and Pakistan became independent states, provided for an option to the native rulers to merge either with India or with Pakistan or to remain independent. It was because of the Herculean effort of Sardar Patel that he could persuade 552 out of 555 states to join the Indian Union. C. Gopalachari, at that time the Governor General of India, signed the accession instruments. Nehru, Patel and Mountbatten promised that the autonomous existence of those princes would be respected. The rulers accordingly surrendered their assets and dissolved their states and merged them with the Union of India. Privy purse payable to the rulers was ad hoc decided on, and it was, to just give you an example, Gwalior 25 lakhs, Indore 15 lakhs, Patiala 17 lakhs, Baroda 26.5 lakhs, Jaipur 18 lakhs, Jodhpur 17.5 lakhs, Bikaner 17.5 lakhs, Travancore 18 lakhs, Bhopal 11 lakhs, Mysore 26 lakhs, and Hyderabad 43 lakhs, etc. In spite of opposition by the Congress, Patel persuaded them to include, at that time the constitution was being drafted, include Article 291 in the constitution and Article 114.2, which provided that the privy purses amount could not be changed and it was payable from the Consolidated Fund of India. And all these amount that I said were payable every year. In 1967 general election, some of the princes joined Swaraj Party and defeated some of the Congress candidates. That probably prompted Indira Gandhi to introduce 24th Constitution Amendment Bill in 1970 and wanted to delete Article 291 and 362 so that privy purses could be stopped. Now, Indira Gandhi had a good majority in the Lok Sabha. So Lok Sabha passed the bill by a vote of 332 versus 154. Mind you required a vote of two-third majority. However, the Prime Minister could not muster two-third majority by one vote in the Rajya Sabha, and the vote count was 149 to 75. Serious embarrassment was a serious embarrassment for Indira Gandhi government, and they wanted to do away with that embarrassment by issuance of presidential order, which was a very unusual way of passing law, of the President V.V. Giri under Article 366, subclause 22 of the Constitution on 6th of September 1970, and by a separate order, the privy purses of every ruler was abolished. Madhava Scindia and others filed a petition in the Supreme Court, that is how the matter came up, challenging their derecognition. Nani argued that the rulership itself was a property and its deprivation had resulted into abrogation of personal liberty. Nani further argued that the guarantees and assurances which were constitutionally given cannot be taken away by an executive by an indirect device, because here it, instead of within the parliament, majority could not be mustered, the president was asked to do away with it. Nani argued that after the Indian Independence Act of 1947, all the princely state became sovereign and independent, but they voluntarily joined the Union Dominion of India. By majority of 7 versus 2, the Supreme Court struck down the presidential order. 9 days after the judgment, Indira Gandhi dissolved the parliament, held fresh elections in 1971 that gave her a huge majority, under which in both the houses she passed a constitution amendment, 26th amendment, and whereby Article 291 and 362 were deleted. But it was an embarrassment that a presidential ordinance was done away with. Now we come to the most important case, not only in Nani's life, but in the life of the nation. That is His Holiness Kesavananda Bharati versus the state of Kerala, called the basic structure case. After a massive mandate in 1971, in the parliamentary election, Indira Gandhi was advised by her learned advisors, Mohan Kumaramangalam, Siddhartha Shankar Ray, and H.R. Gokhale, the law minister, whereby they decided to introduce constitutional amendments to overrule Golaknath case, bank nationalization case, privy purses judgments, and for the purpose of passing economic and social reforms. On 22nd of July 1971, 24th and 25th Constitution Amendment Bills were introduced in the Parliament. 24th Amendment provided that the word law in Article 13 would not include constitutional amendment. By the way, Article 13 of the Constitution provided that no law could take away or abridge fundamental right, and if such a law is passed, it becomes void. So the question was whether a law includes the constitution amendment also. So since in Golaknath case, the Supreme Court had held that, they wanted to do away by passing a constitutional amendment itself. The 25th constitutional amendment provided that any compensation paid at the time of acquiring the property cannot be questioned in any court of law, and the law passed to give effect to directive principles of the state policy cannot be entertained by any court. Again, here the directive principles of state policy are something which are not justiciable in the court of law, but these are the principles on which the parliament is supposed to pass the laws, but they are enshrined in the chapter 4 of the constitution, directive principles. Now, directive principles were never intended to overrule the fundamental right, because fundamental rights are something which can be implemented, which can be enforced in a court of law, either in the High Court under Article 226 or in the Supreme Court under Article 32. Now what happens? His Holiness Kesavananda Bharati Shri Pad Galvaru was Mathadipati of Edinar Mutt. As Mutt property was affected by the Kerala Land Reform Act 1963 and Kerala Land Reform Act of 1969, he went to the court subsequently. In the meantime, the full bench of the Kerala High Court had struck down certain provisions of the said Kerala Land Reform Act of 1963, 1969 and 1971 in some other matters. Supreme Court appeal allowed the certain appeals, thereby invalidating certain crucial provisions. There were other appeals also by other parties pending in the Supreme Court. To put an end to the entire confusion, the Parliament passed the 29th Constitution Amendment in 1972 and inserted all these Kerala Land Reform Acts in the 9th schedule. So it's like a Ganga Snan. So once you put them in the 9th schedule, they cannot be challenged in any court of law. Ultimately, the 24th, 24th, 5th and 29th Constitution Amendment were challenged not only by Keshavananda Bharati, but by the erstwhile rulers, mining, sugar and coal companies. In all, there were 6 writ petitions and 20 intervention applications in the Supreme Court. It was decided to take up Keshavananda Bharati petition as the lead case, and that is how the judgment is cited in this case. The funniest part is that Nani never met His Holiness. His Holiness did not pay any of Nani's fees, but the fees were paid by the other petitioner who has cooperated. The matter lasted in the Supreme Court for 66 days. It has never happened before that any matter has been argued for so many days. Nani argued for 32 days, and his illustrious opponent, Hormaji Sirwai, who was the Advocate General of Maharashtra, but who was called upon by the state of Kerala, who was the respondent in which the laws were passed, to represent it. He argued for 21 days, and the balance was argued by the Attorney General Nirande and other interveners. The 13-judge bench, which was the highest ever assembled, was headed by Chief Justice Sikri. The judgment which is delivered is of 703 pages. Again, never such a huge judgment has been delivered. And it was delivered on 24th of April, 1973, on the second last day of the Chief Justice retiring. Because if he was to retire before the judgment, the whole matter would have been heard by another bench of 13 judges. By a paper-thin majority, again of 7 versus 6, it was held that the amending power under Article 6, incidentally, Article 366 is the article under which the power is given to the legislature to pass laws whereby the constitution can be amended. So it was held that the amending power under Article 366 cannot be used so as to abrogate the basic structure or basic features of the constitution. Now, this concept of basic structure was brought out for the first time in a very big way in this particular matter. The Supreme Court told Nani that forget about this Golaknath case. You tell us whether the law, the meaning of the law, which is in Article 13, means constitutional amendment, and what is the scope of Article 368 as far as the amending power is concerned. Now, Nani relied upon the preamble itself, which says that India will be a sovereign democratic republic. And he enlarged the thing. We are sovereign because we have just earned our independence from the British rule. We are democratic because for the first time we have introduced adult franchise. That is, a person who is more than 21 and now brought down to 18 can vote and throw the government out. And that was not there in the Government of India Act of 1935. And democratic, sovereign, republic, and it was republic because we are. This is on a Westminster model where it is the presidential form of government where the president shall act according to the aid and advice of the prime minister and his council of ministers. So he pointed out that these are the features which a government which has just come for 5 years cannot change because it will otherwise give rise to a dictator coming out of democratic process. Palkhiwala as well as Mr. Sirwai, while arguing this case for a number of days, referred to the judgments of the courts in United States, all the democratic countries, UK, Australia, Canada, Ireland, Ceylon, and also the judgments of the Supreme Court, Federal Court, Privy Council, and also to the debates in the Constituent Assembly. So it was a very huge matter which dealt with the entire law which supported the argument vis-a-vis Article 13 and Article 368. Ultimately, because of this particular doctrine of basic feature, where you can do any, you can pass any law under Article 368, including constitutional amendment, but you cannot change the basic structure. Now, this judgment subsequently has been used even till today. Whenever a parliament passes any law, it is tested on the principle of basic structure, and if it is found that it violates any of the basic feature or basic structure, it is struck down by the Supreme Court. So this was the high point in the career of Nani Palkhiwala, and the freedom-loving citizens of India should eternally be grateful for saving the country from a dictator which could have been created out of democracy. Now, this was a greatest setback to Indira Gandhi, because she wanted to have the full power under Article 368 to do anything that could be done to pass the laws that she wanted to pass. Now, after this historic verdict in Keshavananda Bharati case, case, which came on 24th of April 1974, then 70s, as I said, formulating the basic structure theory, rattled Indira Gandhi and the supporters. The political situation also became very uncomfortable for the government. Railway strike of 1974 was followed by judgment of the Allahabad High Court disqualifying Indira Gandhi for 6 years under Representation of People's Act for indulging in corrupt electoral practices. Indira Gandhi appealed to the Supreme Court, but the vacation judge, V.R. Krishna Iyer, granted a conditional stay whereby she could attend the parliament, but she could not vote in the parliament. And incidentally, Nani Palkhiwala appeared for her in the Supreme Court, because Nani was apolitical. He would appear for any person who sought his help. So she, instead of asking any government functionary or an attorney general, she asked Nani Palkhiwala to represent her. But after finding that she cannot vote in the parliament, Indira Gandhi ultimately declared emergency. The moment the emergency was declared, Nani Palkhiwala returned the brief. And he did not agree the way the emergency was promulgated. Eventually, Indira Gandhi succeeded in the appeal, but Supreme Court struck down Article 39, the 39th Constitution Amendment that prevented election of Prime Minister from being questioned in any court of law. Because by preventing that from happening, you are actually doing away with the judicial review which is available to the higher courts. While her appeal was pending in the Supreme Court, on 20th October 1975, Chief Justice Ray constituted a bench of 13 judges to hear the review of the main judgment in the Keshavananda Bharati case, which was just passed 2 years before, on the point whether basic structure theory restricted Parliament's power to amend the constitution and whether the bank nationalization case was correctly decided. Now, the funniest part is both the points were irrelevant, as 13 judges could not have overruled another judgment of 13 judges. You would have had to have a 15-judge bench. Secondly, the question of re-examination of the judgment in bank nationalization case did not at all arise, because by that time, the particular pursuant to the nationalization, higher compensation was already paid and 14 banks were already nationalized, and there was no controversy that had remained. In the new constituted review bench, only the 5 judges who had heard the main Keshavananda Bharati case in 1970 had remained, and the government packed the bench with committed judges, thinking that was the best way of reviewing the Keshavananda Bharati case. Nani was told that, please, whatever effort that you have done is going to go waste unless you come and appear in the matter and ensure that this particular review is defeated. Nani argued the matter for 2 days. Justice Khanna, who was the judge in the main case as well as on the bench in the review matter, and some of the other judges were of the opinion that the heights of eloquence and advocacy reached by Nani on those 2 days was unparalleled, and that his feat will never be equaled in the Supreme Court. Justice Khanna, in his memoir, has stated that for those 2 days, it was not Nani who was arguing the case, but it was divinity which was speaking through him. I don't think there can be any better compliment to Nani than this. Nani raised many preliminary objections to the maintenance of the review. But the main objection was, he asked the Chief Justice as to who has filed his review petition, And why no copy of the review petition is available? Was it a request of the Union of India orally made? Chief Justice Ray said, no, no. The original petitioner, that means Keshavana Bharti, they only wanted a judicial review. He said, sorry, I am the petitioner's advocate. I never asked for any review. I am quite satisfied with the judgment, which says that basic structure cannot be altered. Then Chief Justice said that even the Tamil Nadu government asked for the review. Advocate General of Tamil Nadu, Govind Swaminathan, who was present in the court, he got up and said, I have asked for no review. Even the Advocate General of Gujarat, J.M. Thakur, informed the court that he had not asked for the review. Chief Justice Ray was embarrassed, as he could not point out as to who had filed the review petition and whether there was actually any petition filed at all. On the third day, while Attorney General Niran Day was on his legs after Nani finished his arguments, the judges came to the court and Chief Justice announced that the bench was dissolved. Why? Because Chief Justice knew that although he was a committed judge, the other so-called committed judges, all 12 of them were against him. And therefore, this was this particular clumsy attempt of Chief Justice himself to review the judgment at the instance of the Prime Minister and his council of ministers was thwarted, even by the committed judges who were flooded on the bench by the government. One more time, Nani saved basic freedoms of the citizen. Now, this is what Nani as a lawyer. Now, let us see what are Nani's qualities. Nani was God's gift to India. This is what was stated by Rajaji, who was none other than the last Governor General of India. The first quality, integrity and credibility. Over a period of this particular quality did not come immediately. Over a period of time, Nani had achieved all this credibility and integrity. If in a particular matter, Nani was to say that on a particular page, the judgment starts, the judges don't have to open the book or the law book. They would believe that what Nani has stated was correct. Then he was loyal toward the professionals and his friends. Rustam Gagrat, the senior partner of Gagrat and Company, was one of the early solicitors who had given brief to a young aspiring lawyer, Nani Palkiwala. So he knew that what is the meaning of a first brief for a lawyer, for some person to have faith in a lawyer goes a long way in lawyer's career to enhance his confidence. So what did he do? He gave the first copy of his first edition of the Income Tax Law and Practice to Rustam Gagrat in reverence. He was a silent philanthropist, as I said, not only to the Shankar Netralay, he gave charity to so many institutions. And he was not the one who wanted to amass wealth or income. In fact, he was the person who helped so many taxpayers in a legitimate way and a legal way to save their income and taxes so that they became rich rather than he having his goal of making a lot of income and wealth, which he distributed among the deserving. He was humble and courteous. As I told you about the Lillian Carter incident, he was humble. He was ambassador of India, but he did not find it below his dignity to help an old lady who was struggling to put her foot into the shoe. He was courteous. He was always courteous, even to his opponents in the court, which I have seen myself. And if his opponent was struggling to find out a particular quotation or a particular statement, Nani would help his opponent to find out on exactly on what page it is. So the courtesy not only was to the lawyer, but also to the judges. Nani never evaded any question put to them by the judges. He gave a straight answer rather than beating around the bush. His willingness to acknowledge mistakes and to continually evolve through self-development. Nani being a human being, he also made mistakes, but he publicly acknowledged if this mistake was found and gave credit to the person who found that mistake, and he wanted to ensure that mistake is not repeated. Then he was completely dedicated towards his work. Nani worked for almost 18 hours throughout his career. I remember his conferences. Sometimes the conferences, the time was given at 12 o'clock midnight because he was fighting against time. So his work was completely devoted. His time was completely devoted to work. He was a perfectionist. To what extent? Every edition of the book, his taxation book, the proof was finally read by him, although his brother Behram helped in doing a lot of work on the book. Finally, it was read by him to see that he doesn't have to attach an errata to the book and there is no printing mistake. He was an exemplary time manager. What did he do? He was called to give lectures, not only the budget speeches, but other lectures in different parts of the country and even abroad. So before he embarked on the journey to go to his destination, he would find out from the travel agent which was the shortest way by which he could go there so that he could save time by not traveling too much, but reaching his destination in the shortest time. So he managed his time so well that apart from that, his other activities, social, religious, etc., activities also found time, activities such as charity, etc., also found time, and he was available whenever at the beck and call of the needy person. Health conscious, not that he went to gym, but he definitely did yoga and he definitely kept himself fit by doing some free arm exercises regularly. And he was very careful about his diet. And therefore, he knew that he could not afford to fall ill for a single day. Compassionate and considerate, apart from charity, he also ensured that whenever his staff or the people whom he knew were in need of any medical or other help, he would be very compassionate and considerate. One of his friends who had suffered a heart problem and was admitted in London, Nani took a flight to London to discuss with the doctor as to which is the best way of ensuring that the disease or whatever that heart problem was could be rectified. He just went for that, which I suppose the person was suffering or his relatives could have done. But no, he was so considerate to his friends and relatives, etc. He loved India. Not only loved India, but he appeared for the government in the international courts pro bono. Please understand, there were lawyers who appeared with him. I don't want to name them because they are big people who charged the government for their fees for appearing with Nani. And Nani did not charge any fees because he took it as his honor that he was asked by the government to represent him, because Nani did not hold any government post. His opponents were appearing through their attorney generals and advocate generals, but Nani treated it as an honor. He treated the prime ministers, maharajas and the common men equally. He attended to all the cases of the prime minister like Indira Gandhi, the maharajas like P.B. Persis and so many other taxation matters, and also common men like R.C. Cooper, and also so many other matters where he found that there was an infraction of fundamental right which had a long-lasting effect, not only on that particular man, but maybe to the humanity in India. The most important aspect of Nani Palkhivala was his phenomenal memory and the grasp. I can tell you from my personal experience, when we had briefed him in one of the matters, the conference time was given as 9 p.m. in the High Court chambers, and a big brief was sent to him a day before. From the look of the brief which was there on his table when he came for the conference, it looked as if he had not opened the brief at all. It was speak and span. But when the conference started, Mr. Ashok Desai was appearing with him in that matter. So he was there in the conference. And when he started asking questions to Ashok Desai, he did not ask about facts because they were all like a photographic memory. They were all stored in his brain. He just asked a few questions about the legal aspect, and that was it. It is our misfortune of my firm that although he was supposed to appear the next day, the matter did not reach on that day. And then we had to withdraw the brief because he was not available on other days. And then we had to brief Mr. Jethmalani, who carried on with the matter. But his memory was fantastic. Other example, you must have seen, as quite a few of you who are listening to this talk might have heard, the budget speeches. Nani used to address the budget speech between 1 hour, 20 minutes to 1.5 hours. Without a piece of paper, and the budget is delivered. He was there to answer not only the queries, but he raised certain points which were taken note of by the finance minister, and at times they were also implemented, because what was introduced was budget. Then it was to be discussed in parliament before it became a finance act. So Nani's phenomenal memory. I have seen in some of the my matters myself, in the court also, Nani was arguing out of his sheer memory. He would quote a paragraph of a judgment out of his memory and recite the entire paragraph or the entire part of the judgment on which he was reciting. So this is something which is absolutely unparalleled. I have not seen a second person. I don't claim to have seen all the lawyers in the country, but I have not seen a second person who could match this. So these are the attributes of Nani, which I felt were really something which was outstanding. And I would personally feel that that with these attributes, Nani should have been given a Bharat Ratna and not a Padma Vibhushan. Well, Padma Vibhushan is all right, was given in his lifetime, but I felt that Nani deserved a Bharat Ratna. So I started a personal campaign, and I was joined in my campaign by the Attorney General, Mr. Venugopal, and also Senior Advocate Arvind Datar. Both of them have taken the cause further. I was quite disappointed on 26 January when I did not find my name, his name in that list. But, well, it can happen anytime. They are going to consult Fali Nariman and Soli Surabji, with whom I had a conversation and they were on board. So if I am now 73 years old, if this happens in my lifetime, I will treat it as a Guru Dakshina from me to my Guru, maybe posthumously. My little contact with Nani, being in 1968, when I joined the law college, Nani Palkhiwala was a professor. Not a professor on a daily basis, he used to address the entire college once in a term. And I remember in 1968, immediately after the Golaknath judgment, there was a debate between Nani Palkhiwala and Barrister Nath Pai. This is something which I have never heard before, definitely at that point of time. While both of them were speaking separately, while you were listening to them, you thought that the person who is speaking is right. But then you go home and you find out that Nani was right and not Barrister Nath Pai. Since 1969, because that is the time when I really started taking a lot of interest in my legal profession, I have heard every single speech that was delivered at CCI East Lawn and at the Brabham Stadium. I had the privilege for a half day to listen to Nani arguing Keshavananda Bharti case in 1973. What I saw, in my opinion, was that here was a maestro, a conductor, and they were 13. There were 13 musicians playing different instruments as per the conductor's gestures. Or to put it otherwise, here was a professor addressing 13 students of constitutional law. As during my presence in the court, there was completely pin drop silence. I had also heard Nani Palkhiwala in quite a few Bombay High Court cases when I was a junior. Whenever we used to know that Nani is going to argue a case, we used to drop everything and go and listen to him, including the famous case of the matter which was there, which where the lawyers wanted to hold their own meeting to consider about the emergency. And that meeting was banned first by the police commissioner and then by the home ministry. And then the matter was taken into the court. That was the NP Nathwani versus police commissioner. Again, something which I have never seen before. When Nani appeared, all the top lawyers of Bombay High Court were present. So Nani, when he appeared, he addressed the bench of Justice Kantawala and Justice Tulsapurkar by saying, "I appear on behalf of the petitioner with my learned friend, Mr. Jethmalani, Mr. Fali Nariman, Mr. Suri Sorabji, Mr. Khattu Cooper, Mr. Anil Diwan, Mr. Ashok Desai, Mr. Iqbal Chagla, and others. Other 137 advocates," and tendered the list. Unfortunately, by the time that matter was decided, Supreme Court decided the matter against the citizen, and therefore that matter could not succeed. That was that ADM Jabalpur versus Shukla. I don't want to go into that. So this is Nani Palkhiwala, the guru, and this is me as the disciple. So, and I end my note by saying that I hope that during my lifetime, I will see Nani as Bharat Ratna. Thank you. If there are any questions, I'm willing to take.
You are not told about his last days of the great man.
Well, last days of the great man is not something which is, which I can say proudly that I was very happy to see. The last days of the great man, unfortunately, he was in a wheelchair. He was also non-functional. He was called upon by the Bombay High Court to celebrate his birthday. He came in a wheelchair. He said that there are two speeches. One is big and one is small. So he said, there's a speech which is thank you. And the other one, bigger speech is thank you very much. Now, this is not what people have come to. This is from Nani Palkiwala. So I would not dwell with the things that happened, unfortunately, during the last days. But I remember when he was fresh and young and he was energetic and the way he fought for the citizens.
Thank you.
Rajanji, you have given a complete picture of the great man. And I don't think there are any questions to be asked because you have explained almost everything that we need to know. It was really a very heartening thing to listen to you for this Thank great you. Personality. Thank you very much.
There is a question which asks, can you please tell us his role in political and social aspects?
As I told you, he was not in politics. He did not want to run for any election. With great difficulty, he was persuaded to accept a sort of a quasi-political position of a ambassador to the United States. Because whenever you take these positions, then you have to compromise your own thoughts and you have to talk about representing the government. Palkiwala all this time did not do, but he thought that by his presence in the United States, he will give a better and a proper picture of India that was at that time under the government of Janata government, and therefore he accepted this. But then it appears in 2 years he started feeling a little suffocated because he was not used to the life of an ambassador. Whatever good thing he could do, he did. He addressed the UN General Assembly and he addressed so many other lectures, etc. But eventually he thought that his better role is in India and that too in court. So in 1979, he resigned and came back to India to start his again career as an advocate.
So would you agree that without Nani and a few people like him, India may not have remained a democracy?
Well, it would have remained as a democracy, but it would have been a different type of democracy. Because if certain laws are passed which cannot be challenged, and if the basic structure is demolished, then technically you can be like a Hitler also became a dictator through democracy only. So people would have come into the power through proper election. But once they come into the power, they could pass any law. They could even pass a law, like Nani gave an example in the Mills case, that you can pass a law since you have power of amendment and which is unbridled, unfettered, you can pass a law saying that instead of 5 years, because the constitution provides that every 5 years there should be election. You can say that all these 5 years, etc. is nonsense. Election should be once in 20 years and you continue. Because the constitutional amendment is properly passed by 2/3 majority because you have already generated that majority, and you amend the constitution. So you can imagine this is only one of the consequences that could follow. So there could be any number of consequences. There the government elected through democratic process will continue to remain there, technically under democracy because it is following the constitution, which is amended and destroyed.
Thank you, sir. Persis, would you like to?
Persis, vote of thanks, please.
We can't hear you, Persis.
Hear me? Hello?
Yeah, louder, please.
Yeah, can you hear me?
No.
Can't hear.
Yeah. Is it better now? Can you hear me, John?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Right. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all our viewers from across the globe. On behalf of WZCC Mumbai Chapter, I thank Mr. Rajan Jaikar for the truly enthusiastic talk on the Padma Bhushan recipient, Attorney General, Mr. Nani Palkhivala. One of Mr. Rajan Jaikar's webinar was titled, Nani Palkhivala, God's Gift to India. True to being an adherent fan of Mr. Nani Palkhivala, Mr. Rajan Jaikar has done complete justice to his guru. He has made us aware of the illustrious contributions of Mr. Nani Palkhivala, not only in the legal fraternity by narrating some interesting cases, but also Mr. Nani Palkhivala as a magnanimous supports, all his magnanimous supports in various other areas. And we can certainly learn a lot from his personal life principles. We wish Mr. Rajan Jaikar every success in campaigning the support for the Bharat Ratna to be conferred upon Mr. Nani Palkhivala, the legend indeed. Yeah, the day won't end if we don't thank Mr. Yazdi Tantra for hosting our webinar as always. We thank Mr. Edel Darwa for always being over here for attending our webinars and giving us constant encouragements. And thank you, Mr. Jaikar, for all the support that you've got. You've got some wonderful remarks from Percy Master on Nani Palkhivala. And yes, we thank you very much for all the insights that you have given us. And we wish you all the very best. And I'm sure you're no less, an eminent personality. And congratulations for all your achievements too.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Thank you very much.
I think we can end now.